Holy Spirit, I am here. Come in your might and lead me to your perfect will.
Making idols. Using the images religiously do not necessarily mean idolatry. I told you all that in the scripture, right? Where God is able to don't make images, also has the people to make images. Let me finish on that before I now tell you the idolatry of our time. I will now tell you the new idols. But first of all, let's go to Mark chapter 12. Mark 12, I read from verse 14. Okay, from verse 14. Next, they sent him some Pharisees and some Herodians to cast him out to what he said. This came to him and said, Master, we know that you are an honest man, that you are not afraid of anyone, because human realm means nothing to you. And that you teach the way of God, not honesty. Is it permissible to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay or not? Recognizing their hypocrisy, he said to them, why are you putting me to the test? Hand me a denarius and let me see it. They handed him one and he said to them, whose image is this? Whose title? They said to him, Caesar. Jesus said to them, pay Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and God what belongs to God. And they were amazed. Okay. So, image this. They wanted to trap Jesus. So they brought the Adjutant of Life right to pay taxes. Now for a Jew to pay tax to the Roman government, which they consider as a pagan government, is like telling the Jew that you have another God. And then to work through the matter, the money you use to pay the tax has the image of who on it? Caesar. So it was so serious for them that if you were coming to the temple to do offering or to do anything, you wouldn't bring the Roman money into the temple. That's why they have money changers. So before you can do any offering in the temple, you must exchange whatever currency you have with the Jewish shekel. So for Jesus to say to them, pay tax to Caesar. Jesus is saying, for them, in their mindset, that is like saying, oh, so we should now worship Caesar. But look at what Jesus said to them, say, whose image is this? They say, Caesar. But Jesus said, give to Caesar what belongs. You know, it's not saying, paying tax with a coin that has the image of Caesar does not necessarily mean idolatry. Your intention is not to worship Caesar, your intention is to do what? Pay tax. And this is the legitimate currency or money for paying tax. So, if image is what qualifies for idolatry, it means that using a coin that has the image of Caesar to pay tax. Idolatry, but you don't really see it that way. Praise God. Are you following me? Then bowing down before images, or bowing down before anyone. Now I'm through. Some people regard bowing before images as idolatry. I don't know why that's the problem. Among the Yoruba, when you want to greet, what do you do? They are not even bowing. They do what? They do what? They proceed, even blessed sacraments, you don't even know. Is that idolatry? I'm asking, is that idolatry? It's not idolatry. Because the intention is not to worship the person, it's a cultural expression of what? And I will show you that in the Bible. Also, put Genesis 23 verse 12. Are you calling somebody for what? I'm going to say it's idolatry. Put Genesis 23, verses 10, 11, and 12, so that we can end there with the truth. Genesis 23, Now, Israel was present there among the sons of Joseph. So in the hearing of all who went in at the gate of the city, Ephraim the Hittite answered Abraham, saying, "Oh, my Lord." Okay, who is he calling my Lord? Does that mean Abraham is God? Yeah. So when they are saying, when we come to Bishop, my Lord, I know some of you have problems with this. When we are coming to Bishop, specifically my Lord, my Lord. And some of you might be having problems with that. That word is different from Adonai. That word means master, or God. Lord, or God, they all use the same thing. They say, "Oh, my Lord, hear me. I give you the field and the king that is in me, I give you. In the presence of the sons of my people, I give it to you. Bury your dead." Then Abraham, he did what? Before who? What did he do? Is that worthy? Huh? I'm asking you. Is that worthy? No. So bowing to another human being, So, let's go and see what we mean. I don't know if you saw that. I don't know if it's not just the making of images. It is the making of an image to be a God. I don't know if it's not the making of an image, but the making of an image of God. The making God of an image. That is what I want. And that will take us to Exodus 32. Let's go to the name of the Lord now. Exodus 32. Let me show you what the name of the Lord is. The fact that we carry this, does not make adoration intentional. But I remember the story of 2 months. 3 months who never came out of the army. They are going to be killed. So if they were to come out, they will go around their family and family. So one day, 2 of these monks were coming and usually cross the river, the big river, to get to the answer. So when they got to the bank of the river, they saw one pretty woman. She was scared of water, she could be crossed. And one of the monks mercifully lowered himself, and the woman crying her back. Very pretty woman. So he carried her across the water. As they were going, the other one just came with me. "This is my brother. He's carrying a woman. So when they crossed the river, his colleague dropped the woman as they were going. He kept talking. He said, "How can you a monk touch a woman?" So they said that he carried a woman. He kept talking. The other one now got out and said, "You know, I dropped that woman safely at the bank of the river, and you are still carrying her in your hand. What is your problem?" Intention. Most idolaters or most idols are not physical. I'm going to show you that in the Bible. Let's go to the real idolatry. Genesis chapter 10, Exodus chapter 32, the story of the golden calf. Listen very well. When the people saw that Moses was a long time before coming down the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Get to work. Make us a god. Make us what? Make us what?" Did they say make us an image? No. They said, "Make us a god to go out, to go at our head. For that Moses, the man who brought us here from Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron replied, "Strip off the gold rings from the ears of your wife and your sons and daughters and bring them to me." The people all stripped off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He received what they gave, he melted it down in a mold, and with it made the statue of a calf. Israel the people shouted, "Here is your God who brought you from Egypt." Observing this, Aaron built an altar before the statue and made his proclamation. Tomorrow will be a feast in Yahweh's honor. Early next morning, they sacrificed burnt offering and brought communion sacrifices. The people then sat down to eat and drink, and afterwards got up to amuse themselves. So they left the statue, and then they said, "Israel, here is your God who brought you out of Egypt." What have they done? I told you before that idolatry is not representation. Idolatry is replacement. They just replace them. Replacement and substitution. That is idolatry. They just replace them. But first of all, let me show you what they done to that idolatry. Before they made the image, they were already cooking up idolatry. Why did they make the image? They said to Aaron, "Moses has been gone for long. We don't know what has happened to him. Maybe he has even died." So they called a God. Because we know what has become of Moses. So see the problem here. The replacement of God did not start in the absence of Moses. It started long again with Moses. In other words, the people have come to see Moses as God. So the absence of Moses is the absence of God. The presence of Moses is the presence of God. Without Moses, there is no God. With Moses, there is God. So gradually, they have softly begun to replace God with Moses. The making of the statue is just a concretization of what has been in the mind. I decided in Exodus 19, all through to 20, when Moses brought them to Mount Sinai at the application of the covenant, you remember the story, and God came with thunder, with lightning, and other things, and spoke, and gave them some instructions. Then you go to Exodus chapter 20, when God began to give them the Ten Commandments and all of that. When they finished, having seen all those thunder, all those lightning and so they were afraid. They said to God, "Please, don't speak to us next time. Whenever I want to speak to us, speak to Moses. Don't even come to us. We don't want to see you." Replace me. Praise God. Are you following me? So idolatry is replacement. The people were already showing the seed of idolatry in Moses. They said, "They are only fooling us and become of Moses." They became so attached to Moses that they couldn't see beyond Moses. And that is what I call immature spirituality. Many of us are guilty of this today. How many of you see God beyond the minister you love? If I didn't see Jesus today, what happened to one of us? Let me ask you, what happened to one of us? The idolatry of our time is even found in the church, with worshippers who are worshipping their men and their women of God instead of God. That is why a Christian, if he insults Jesus Christ, he may not do anything. But insult Pastor Oyedepo, or Pastor P.D. Joshua, or Father Mbaka, or Father Osinewele, or Edibe Monso, just insult anyone that they like, that they admire. Because do not think they can go to people. When any man or woman, no matter the position the person occupies, gets the place of God in your life, you have already graduated, started drifting to work.
Because the people see Moses, they can't see him. So the absence of Moses for them means the absence
from them. And that was part of what the apostles were suffering when Jesus wanted to leave. They were used to see Jesus in the flesh. Now Jesus is saying, I'm going to go. Then he came to Jesus and said, if you love me, you would have been glad to know that I'm going. But look at all of you after God has said, I'm going. Then he said, then listen, if I do not go, the Holy Spirit will not. In other words, you have got to get used to seeing me now, not in the flesh anymore, but be conscious of my presence in you, in the Spirit. Take responsibility as men who are grown in the Spirit. Let me tell your neighbor, grow up. Seriously, tell somebody to grow up. When I was teaching last week, I mentioned about sacramental. Another part of idolatry is if you are used to wearing roses, and then one day you wake up and you have come out and discover that your roses is not in your bed, and then they have come to your mind, hey, see me, they are with you, they will kill you immediately. They are rushing back to go and carry the roses. Then it means that you now believe that without the roses, God cannot be saved. That's a Christian. Or the Catholic. Anointing oil, the food. There are some of you that can go to without anointing oil. Bath, the first thing to do, the drop it in water. Eat, you must anoint your food. Christians anoint their food now. They no longer say great devotion, they anoint their food. You buy new clothes from the market, you anoint it. Where is your faith? My problem is not the use of God, but when you become, there's something called obsession, fixation. When you are fixated on those things, you can't do without them anymore. That's the problem of the people of Israel. They can't do it. Since you can't see it, that means you can't see God. Who is that man or woman that is blocking God from? So that anything he says on earth is in God. That's why some people follow their men of God or women of God stupidly and foolishly and mumulously. When we say it's not an exaggeration, there are some women that don't sleep with their husband once they are. Mommy is the Lord, and daddy is the Lord, but don't sleep with your husband. You have died that spirit. It used to grow. There was a time it used to be like, if his father says, he's true. So one man died, and then he said, he's got faith. Those days, his father, against reality, against evidence, they want to follow what the man of God. The man of God is taking the place of God completely in your life. Some of you are so scared of death. The reference you give to them, God does not get you. Take idolatry. That is what gave rise to the molding of God. Molding is no longer there. You don't know what happened. It will make us be God. So, in other words, for them, God must be physical. God must be physical. But then God must be physical. So be careful. If you get so attached to anything or anyone, and that thing becomes the only means through which you can hear God or see God, then there is a problem. You can't tell the man to a thing. When two or three gather in my name, I am where? I am there. That is not because of anybody. It's not because of anybody. We're talking about them and the enemy and this. That I live in you and attach it I can't stop preaching in John chapter 6. A Eucharistic Christian is not supposed to be doing something. Any of you who is in the world, I can't do it. My Father will love you, shall come. Let us go with you. So grow. If Christians do not need to take responsibility, that abdicate their responsibility and then hand over, as the Galatians call it, the minus. Their spiritual treasure are the hands of others. Minus. Who is your idol? Who has given an idol in your life? Genesis 32 is where we see the people of Israel committing the sin of idolatry. They replaced God. They substituted God. And I don't even know why they changed power of all animals. Why did they change power? Because when they are doing the same thing on that, they didn't even take the animal. Or all of them. Did you leave? And that's what I did. So it could be anything. Praise God. So once more, idolatry is not representation. Idolatry is replacement. I am a representation, a representative. So you are a representative. But the moment I replace God, you have started practicing idolatry. So what are the idols of today, quickly? The idols of today, they are not images, like I said. So the number one idol of today, we find it in 2 Corinthians. I have also put it on the screen. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. The number one idol. And that says, are you there? 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And that says, we are all going to live together. There are about four items. We are not projecting our own. We just have this before. For the celebration, for although we are human, it is not by human methods that we do battle. Continue. The weapons with which we do battle are not those of human nature, but they have the power in God's cause to demolish fortresses. It is what? What? It is what? It is ideas that we demolish. Continue. Every presumptuous notion that is set up against the knowledge of God. And we bring every thought into captivity and obedience to Christ. It is ideas. First idolatry of our time is ideas. Any idea that is opposed to Christ, to the knowledge of Christ, to the word of God, is an idol or is idolatry. Secularism. Secularism means that human beings are in charge. God does not exist. Where does the idea of homosexuality come from? We no longer want to accept that God made us male and female. Transgender. Scientists one day can take a woman and turn her into a man. And take a man and turn him into a woman. Gender neutrality. Over there now, they are saying that when you give birth, when you give their parents, they say you shouldn't name your child after a baby. For example, if you say yes, don't name her after a baby. Let her grow. When she grows, she can decide to become a baby. That is how gay rights started. And before you know it, they are having marriage. Now they are starting, and we think they are playing. The parents do not have right to call a child boy or girl. When the child grows, the child will decide which one, he or she, well, whether I want to be a he or a she, or still see him, he or she. And it begins like a joke. It begins like a joke. What are the ideas? Mobility. Mobility is part of the problem. It's a problem of this idea. Idea that you can make money with anything. You can do anything to make money. Or you do anything that pleases you. Even if it's wrong, contrary to God's will. Do you remember? I don't know whether I drank my cake. There was one World Cup that the Coca-Cola game was going crazy. I don't know whether I drank my cake. But thank you to God, it's like people outside make them to join them. The advert is during the World Cup, a man came home and his wife was cooking in the kitchen. There was a television, and then one team scored goal. And as they were celebrating, the boyfriend of the woman, whom she just knew something had got to me, couldn't contain his excitement. He came out of the room naked. And the husband who just came in saw him. And he told that my wife had committed adultery. But because they scored goal, and everybody was just, all of them started rejoicing. The man embraced the daughter, the wife embraced the daughter. It was an answer, but it didn't stay for long. I see people complain. What was that answer saying now? That because of football, our daughter is no longer attached. Any idea that softly brings or suppresses the truth. And there are so many of them. So many of them that people can do whatever they want. When they want. Romans chapter 1 is specific to the same. Because there is no time to answer the very thing. Romans 1 is specific to the same. So the retribution of God from heaven is being reduced against the ungodliness. And the injustice of human beings who is their injustice hold back the truth. For what can be known about God is perfectly plain to them since God has made it plain to them. Ever since the creation of the world, the invisible existence of God and his everlasting power have been clearly seen by the minds of the standing of created things. And so these people have no excuse. They knew God, and yet they did not honor him as God. Or give thanks to him, but their arguments became futile and their uncomprehending minds were darkened. While they claimed to be wise, in fact, they were growing so stupid that they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for an imitation, for the image of a mortal human being or a bird or animal or crawling things. They exchanged the glory of God. That's idolatry. Hallelujah. 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 So it is ideas that we get up. And that is why Christians, it is not enough to pray. To counter an argument, to bring a superior argument. That's why you should also be wise. Do you know what is called planned parenting? Have any of you heard about planned parenting? Planned parenting is the systematic enthronement of abortion. Under planned parenting, you can do abortion even when the baby is almost 9 months in the womb. Under planned parenting, they do abortion, the doctor is even freedom to cut the neck, the head of the baby that is fully developed. And they are funding this with government money.